Hi, you're watching India Post Live, India's first web TV news conversation portal. I'm Shivraj, and today we're discussing the issue of cancer on the rise. You too can join in on the conversation by logging on to our website, indiapostlive.com. You can also tweet with us, use hashtag IndiaPostLive. So is cancer becoming an epidemic in India? If the Lancet Medical Journal report is to be believed, then the numbers are rising every year. But are Indians really aware of the enormity of the disease? Let's take a look.
Is cancer still the menace that ravages Indians? Well, yes. The Lancet Oncology, a leading medical journal, has published its report, and the message is loud and clear for us. The report mentions lack of facilities to tackle cancer patients in almost 95% of our medical colleges. No wonder nearly 700,000 Indians die of cancer every year, and a million are newly diagnosed with it. Breast cancer and oral cancer are the most common cancers in India. Pollution plays a great part, while unhealthy lifestyle habits have also led to the alarming rise in cancer cases. But what's really the concern is the fact that only 3 out of 10 patients survive for more than 5 years after diagnosis. It's not just high cost of treatment, but lack of awareness and late diagnosis. Will we still continue to live in denial?
Do join in on that conversation with us. In studio, we have two experts, Dr. Danny Gupta, who's an oncologist and consulting with the Dharamshila Hospital and Research Center. Harmala Gupta, who started CanSupport, a palliative and support group for cancer patients and survivors. And, Dr. Danny Gupta, this is really based on the Lancet Medical Journal that's projecting 1.1 or 1.3 million deaths over the next 20 years in India, given the lack of facilities and the lack of understanding. Are you worried?
See, actually, what I believe, these data should not create panic in the society.
Sure.
We are aware as a doctors and as a, I think some patients are also coming to us with the idea, okay, doctor, should I need to check them, me and my family members for the cancers? Should I go for screening? Irrespective of whether they have any family members with the cancers or not. See, because nowadays they are getting the news like every... If we take breast cancer, 1 in 8 females can get breast cancer in their lifetime. So it's so high risk in the family, in the females. And nowadays we have a lot of screening methods like clinical breast examination, mammography, with which we can detect at earlier stage. So stage of the cancer is very important. If it is diagnosed in early stage, so survival is very good. Like if you see in US, previously cancers, overall survival, 5-year survival was around 70%. Mm-hmm. And nowadays it's up to 90%. I am talking about breast cancer particularly. And even in India, even nowadays, it's only hardly 70%. Because it's still being diagnosed at a later stage, advanced stage. So there is urgent need for creating awareness in the society, as well as in the, among the, particularly in the family members of the cancer patients.
Also, Harmala, you know, meeting you 15 years ago when you started CanSupport, you said the biggest problem was sensitization and education around the disease. Has much changed since then?
I think it has. And simply because of the fact that now everyone knows someone, whether it's in their family or in their friend circle, who's been touched by cancer. And so the conversation has started taking place. I also feel the fact that, we now have support groups for people with cancer, for their families, services that go out into the community, such as CanSupport. We run a home care program. So that is also spreading the word about cancer. But I still fear there are a lot of misconceptions about this disease, mm-hmm. which hold people back. And I think that there is still a great need to have much more education out there. And coupled with the education, you have to make it easy for people also to go for their checkups. You know, what happens is very often you can tell people this is what you need to do, but they find it impossible then to take the next step, which is they don't know where to go, who should they be talking to about this. If they, for example, a woman finds a lump in her breast, does she go to a surgeon? Is she supposed to go to a gynecologist? or should she just go to her local GP? So I think that we still need much clearer guidelines as to what people should do.
And who should, Harmala, really be behind this? Is it public policy, government, or should it be society at large, civil society organizations like yourself?
I think it has to be a combined effort, because India is a vast country, it's a huge country. Organizations like us have a limited reach, whereas we have to cover people in rural areas, in urban areas, people who speak different languages and dialects. Everyone needs to receive the news about cancer, because it is going to be one of the major diseases that is going to affect us in our lifetimes. We are living today long enough to see a rise in cancer, because one of the, one of the factors that predisposes you to cancer is age. Mm-hmm. The longer you live, the greater are your chances of getting a cancer. And so even as we are winning the battle against infectious diseases, we are at the moment losing it against non-communicable diseases.
Right.
So whether it's diabetes, whether it's heart, cancer, you know, these are going to be the major killers.
And Dr. Dani, as Harmala pointed out, it's fine, you know, in urban centers, there is a much easier, focus and easier reach that you can have. How far, as a specialist, as an oncologist observing the disease, have you seen education really spreading beyond that to other parts of India?
See, in other parts of India, it's really lacking right now. And only in the metro cities, I am seeing there is much awareness through medias, through these camps, lot of camps, NGOs like ma'am is saying. And I know Indian Cancer Society in Delhi, which is very much active, which was started by Mr. K.K. Mehta. And they are organizing like Cancer Jagriti. There is a one unit through which they are spreading the campaigns. And they are going a way beyond, like in villages. I know in some Haryana, UP.
And how much of it is public funding, you know, coming from government, throwing the weight behind? Because advocacy and education and all the other things seem to be so secondary in the view of how much support they give in terms of funds, right?
No, means what?
The NGOs, so how much is the government throwing its weight behind these efforts, the advocacy, the education, the other things other than just...
Government, I know in Delhi, there is one center, IRCH and Delhi State Cancer Institute. So a lot of patients are getting cancer treatment in this institute, which are running by the government, Delhi government. And in these Delhi government hospitals, they are arranging some media campaign for educating the patients, whosoever is attending the hospital, not because of malignancy, for other purpose also, they are also exposed to that media campaign. But I need, there is some improvement should be there in other hospitals also. Actually, government is concentrating only on 4 or 5 hospitals in Delhi. Mm-hmm. For this cancer treatment, they should expand this area of this thing.
And so what do you make of statistics like 80% patients consult doctors at a stage where recovery is rare and treatment then becomes that much more prohibitively expensive?
See, actually, problem starts, like recently I saw one case of CA breast, it was in stage 3. And incidentally, I saw her mammography, which was done 2 years back, and she had shown to some gynecologist.
And that goes back?
Yeah, and she said it's okay. Although it was written in the mammography report that it is based pearl calcification, and at that time if she had gone for this testing, further testing, then probably that time it was stage 1.
Okay. And that goes back to what you were saying, Harmala,
yeah.
That I think that there is still a huge gap in the arena of explaining to public at large where they should go for what. Because, you know, I remember when we were doing a few studies on the HPV, a phenomenon, you know, cervical cancer. A lot of women wouldn't go to their gynecologist because they're being judged because it was outside the confines of marriage or institutions like that, right? So it is still a huge gap.
I think so. I think people have to realize that, cancer is a disease like any disease. You don't necessarily invite it in any way. It shouldn't be carry a stigma of any kind. It can happen to anyone, anytime. And that you should treat it in that way. What happens, unfortunately, is I feel that cancer in our country, sadly, still carries a stigma. People want to hide it. So part of the reason also why people don't come, even if, for example, they discover that there's something wrong, is because they say, what if it's cancer? You know, because they start
what
thinking
the fallout?
Oh, yes, the fallout. the effect on the family, how people are going to regard them in their job, what is the future if they're unmarried, for example, when it comes to finding a marriage partner, all these issues begin to weigh in on them. And often that stops people also in their track. So I also feel there's a great need to educate society, to have people like me, who I'm a cancer survivor,
sure,
come out and say, I've had cancer, I'm completely normal today, you know, I'm leading a productive life, and so can anyone else. So I think we have to break that barrier somehow.
The taboo.
That taboo, and talk more about it. Use that word, you know, and demystify it. And the other thing, of course, is talking about rural areas. You see, I remember going for some of these camps to these areas, and the people said to me, okay, now you discover I have a cancer. Then what? Are you going to pay for my treatment?
Absolutely.
In a cancer hospital. I can't afford that treatment. So, kehne aapne samajh lijiye mere ghar pe aag laga di, lekin bujhane ke liye mujhe kuch nahi diya. So that's why, you know, we have to have a program that offers people a way forward as well, which they can afford, which doesn't become an unacceptable burden on them or the family, where people say, I'm sorry, you know, I can't continue with these treatments because we don't have the money. It's a death sentence at the moment for some people, even though they have a treatable cancer.
Okay. So joining us via Skype in this conversation is journalist Mishti Varma. Mishti, you've been listening in on the conversation we've been having. What are your views on the sort of Lancet report that's saying that cancer is becoming an epidemic? Our guests in studio saying that it's preventable, yet education is a huge gap. Also, support and access is a huge issue.
I do agree with both the perspectives, but one thing which Dr. Saab said, we need to create a panic about it.
Sure.
We need to create a panic about it because that's the only way information can be disseminated to every strata of society everywhere. It should not be confined to only those people who have access to private hospitals and doctors who listen to them. It should also be, you know, sent out to the guys in dispensaries who are treating people from JJ Colony clusters, for example. They need to know, if nothing else, they need to know how they can prevent it. How they can, you know, for example, since we're talking about breast cancer so much, it is something which has a very visible physical manifestation, you know, unlike ovarian cancer, for instance. So they can, education can be brought about to women, at least, you know, they can be conscious, they can examine their bodies, for example. And I would also say that even at school level, we can, especially in high schools, we can talk about, we can, you know, at least talk about things like cervical cancer.
Right.
There are vaccines for that. It happens in the US. My 10-year-old nephew in the US is being administered cervical cancer vaccines, my nephew, because who knows how a strain can turn out, how a strain of cancer in the genes can manifest itself. So if that can happen in a first world country, and we with our resources, with our population, which is so vulnerable, we should do it doubly so. At least start something somewhere so that we don't end up losing people and we don't end up losing money. That's
right.
A big issue for Indians.
Absolutely. That, Danny Gupta, that's a valid point. You know, also there have been findings by the Lancet report and others that a lot of our own medical colleges don't have proper cancer research and care centers as well. So it is a huge, huge gap that exists.
Yeah, definitely, as I told you, there is a huge gap, definitely. Only few centers are doing the work in that direction. I think there should be more and more centers should be coming up. And I would rather say ki we should not use the word panic. We need to create panic. Panic word is something different.
But at least break the taboo demystify the whole concept.
We should create more and more awareness.
Okay.
We should use the word awareness rather than using the panic.
And you know, what about the issue of causality? Right, you know, and I remember I've had this conversation in drawing room conversations about, you know, if someone in my family had cancer, how much more of a chance? Reports say that 80% of the cancers in India, or 40% at least, are related to tobacco. Breast cancer is the other big cancer. What about causality? How do you explain that to people? Because it's a very complex issue.
Yeah, it's complex because thing is that causality is different with different organs. Like breast cancer is different, cervical cancer different, liver cancer different, oral cavity cancer is different. In breast cancer, for example, we see around 80% are sporadic, means they are not familial. Only 20% cases are familial. And in the familial, we know around 5 to 10% are true hereditary, means BRCA1 and BRCA2. There are two molecular tests which are available nowadays. And some NGOs are doing it at a cheaper rate nowadays, roughly around 25,000 or 50,000, which were used to be in lakhs, 2-3 lakhs. So, but there is a another way, another point is that lot of people of every breast cancer patient's family members are coming to us, sir, hum apna BRCA kara lein kya? Educated family. So, awareness is creating the thing, but some in different way. We should create the awareness in proper direction.
And how important, Harmala, are cancer survivors in the whole process of actually going out and demystifying and educating people?
I think they're very important because a survivor gives a positive message. And often what holds people back is the fact that they equate cancer with the end of the road, mm-hmm. death, you know, mm-hmm. no one survives sort of thing. Mm-hmm. So even if I have it, you know, what's the point? But I think if a survivor is there and says, there is a point. Because if you catch it early, you can be treated and you can get well again. So I think they can give this message in a much more powerful and positive way. And I just want to add on, 40% of our cancers, even the Lancet report mentions this, are related to tobacco use.
Sure.
Now this is something that is in our hands. If you don't use tobacco, you won't get this cancer. It's as simple as that. Now we have, of course, done a lot in terms of banning cigarette smoking. But what about BD smoking? Large number of our and chewing tobacco.
Right. We're signatories to the 2005 treaty and yet implementation is an issue. Do you think it's because of a lack of political will?
I think they're also very strong lobbies, don't forget. Mm-hmm. In the West, how hard they had to fight against the tobacco lobby. We ourselves have had to fight very hard against the tobacco lobby to even get those messages on cigarette packets. Mm-hmm. And the fight is not over because majority of people in this country with oral cancers, head and neck, and Dr. Gupta knows this much better than I do, come with cancers that have been caused by the habit of chewing tobacco. You know, and that's not something that affects you and I. You don't even know if anyone's chewing tobacco, unlike cigarette smoke, mm-hmm. where you had a hoo-ha because I'm sitting next to you and I said, I'm passively smoking. How do you fight this? Mm-hmm. And with a lobby that has made the little packets so attractive, so affordable, you can get them anywhere, you know. So we need to really pay attention to this menace.
And Mishti, you had something to say as well, right?
My point was actually not just about tobacco smoking, mm-hmm. but we also must remember that cancer is not one thing. It's not breast cancer, not necessarily will affect just the breast. Mm-hmm. It will, if it metastasizes, it spreads.
Sure.
I think that is something which people don't immediately think when they think, oh, cancer hua, ek jagah ka hua hai na.
So it goes back to early detection, right, Mishti, as well? It goes back to the issue of early detection and education?
It goes right there. And also, I think, since you know something, in schools these days, children are being sensitized towards things like turning vegetarian. Mm-hmm. In a lot of private and government schools, that's the thing happening. Why can't they be sensitized towards cancer? I know a child who developed blood cancer at the age of 11. Mm-hmm. He didn't have any vices, no smoking, no drinking, nothing like that. Cancer did not run in either parents' family. He just ended up having blood cancer. It was luckily detected. And oh yes, he was an athlete. He was a state-level athlete, but the child managed to survive after, I think, 1.5 years of chemotherapy. So, you know, it's something that happens irrespective of genetics, irrespective of lifestyle. It just happens. And so therefore, sensitization is so important because you know what? Once that is done, other things will fall into place. Once people are sensitized and educated, other things will fall into place, such as care, such as taking that fatal step when you're 17, should I have my first cigarette or not? For example, that's tobacco smoke, if so, it's so closely linked to cancer, then this is how you do it, to sensitize mm-hmm. people from the beginning, demystify the vices, as it were.
And Dr. Danny, how much of education is being spread at the level of school? Because I know when we went to school, but that was so many years ago, we never really discussed these issues.
So, few years back, I had gone to some school in Barakhamba for this type of one program was there, organized by the school. So, as such, it's not there in the school curriculum, but some schools take initiative through the help of our institutes, कि सम डॉक्टर्स स्पेशलिस्ट कम्स टू देम टू देयर क्लासरूम्स एंड डिस्कस अबाउट द कैंसर्स एंड ओपन क्वेश्चन आंसर फॉर्म शुड बी देयर अमंग द स्टूडेंट्स. देयर वर साइंस स्टूडेंट्स, मैथमेटिक्स, एवरी फील्ड ऑफ स्टूडेंट्स वर देयर टिल 12th स्टैंडर्ड. सो आई थिंक इट शुड बी इनकॉर्पोरेटेड इन द करिकुलम प्रॉपर इन द प्रॉपर वे, नॉट हाफ हार्टेडली. इट विल हेल्प. दैट्स इट.
And Harmala, you know, Dr. Siddharth Mukherjee's book, you know, raised the level of consciousness about the disease. But at the base level, like the rural populations you were talking about, how much access do organizations like you have to funding, public funding, not just you going out and having to raise it from private sources?
You know, for us, it's been an uphill struggle, frankly, because palliative care, which is what we do, which is making people comfortable once their cancers have spread, and cancer treatments are not going to help anymore, is something that has only very recently been recognized and incorporated into the medical curriculum. There's an MD now in palliative medicine at last. Just recently we had the NDPS bill amended, so that oral morphine, which is the drug of choice for unrelenting pain, is more easily accessible.
And I know that you've written a lot about palliative care. For a layperson, what does that really entail?
It means, you know, as we've said, 70-80% of people come with advanced cancer. Sooner or later, they'll find out that the treatments have not worked, that their cancer is spreading. It is possible that now they are going to be faced with some unpleasant physical symptoms, such as pain, maybe diarrhea. And these need to be attended to. The point is, it's quality of life that matters always from day one. And in fact, palliative care is not end of life care. Palliative care is good symptomatic care and relief, which begins from the moment you're diagnosed, because you may have some symptoms that need to be relieved. But so this is important, because people often say, I don't want to suffer, and that's fair. So it's relieving suffering, on the physical suffering, and what I would say in an area we completely neglect, the psychosocial. Mm-hmm. The psychosocial side of things. First of all, coping with a diagnosis like cancer.
Absolutely.
Helping not only the patient but the entire family cope. Mm-hmm. And then when we are dealing with people at the end of life or who have been told the cancer has recurred, what happens to them? How do you prepare them, you know, to face the future? And so that they have a good resolution at the end. Mm-hmm. So I think these are, and unfortunately the government has only just recently now come up with some kind of policy for palliative care. And as I said, when 70% of your cancer population needs it, you need to have this in place.
And Mishti, I'm just going to draw you in there, the psychosocial dimension, the aspect of that kind of understanding at the height of dealing with the disease, whether it's yourself or family members. How important do you see that? Do you see that actually happening, or is it still only in pockets?
The stigma is there, but you know, it's probably at an unexpected level. As everybody else was saying, that cancer, everyone knows somebody who has had cancer or heard of somebody who's had cancer. But the stigma comes in different ways. I know a lot of my friends who, when they were going through the rounds for arranged marriages, the future spouses were asking them, does cancer run in your family? Could it affect our children if we have any? That was unexpected. That was unheard of. But it is a valid question to ask. And then I know of instances where marriages were broken off. You know, the thing didn't just work out because they said, oh, you know, my uncle had cancer. He died of cancer. So it has come out in a very unexpected way. But yes, there is some form of stigma, because these things are again related to cost of healthcare. What if my wife, because she has cancer in the family, she develops it 10 years from now? Will we be able to afford the care? What if our child has the gene? So that is an issue. It's probably relegated to pockets, but it is there.
Harmala, how does one deal with that kind of thinking? Because I think that's valid what Mishti is saying, because there will always be in Indian society that kind of talk when marriage comes up or, you know, linkages come up.
But people need to get the right information. You
sure.
know, that this is nothing but ignorance.
Mm-hmm.
People should know that cancer is not a hereditary disease. It's not something you can pass on. There are very few cancers where we see a linkage with genetic material, and it seems to run in families. There are very few and in between. And therefore, you know, we need to get this information out. People need to, you need to counsel
Absolutely.
People,
so
you need
just,
to counsel
in fact,
couples.
Got a tweet as well saying cancer is considered the first step of moving out. Everyone starts giving condolences. Why? You do survive cancer.
Of course you do. And this is why I feel more and more of us, people like me, survivors who have had the benefits of treatments that have worked, need to come out and say, come on. You know, we are alive, we are living, and there's no reason why you can't continue a normal life. And I think it's when this happens, for example, in the West, there was a time when they hid cancer, there was a time when it carried a stigma. How did this change? It changed with good information, information that was out there. It changed because people came out. They said, I had cancer. They had support groups for breast cancer and other cancers. And everyone knew almost anyone who had. And more importantly, as people began to, the awareness was raised, people went for timely checkups because you don't go when you start mm-hmm. feeling symptoms. You go before that.
In fact, that's related to a tweet you know? That's come in, you know, where a person saying cancer, ignoring it is the biggest mistake we commit.
So they were able to bring down their rates, their death rates,
that's
dramatically.
That's in fact what Dr. Dani began, you know, the discussion with. But Dr. Dani, the other question that everyone's asking is, you can only stem the tide when you go deeper into rural pockets of India. What is the state when it comes to doctors actually going down to rural India? Because in a lot of cases, you don't even see some areas have access to basic health support or delivery.
So like we are used to going to these rural areas, we organize the camps. And in camp, with simple like oral cavity examination, we get to know ki whether there is any pre-malignant lesion or not, like is ulcer which is not healing. The people are taking tobacco quid, betel quid, supari, pan masala, and sort of all these things.
And so what about what Mishti and Harmala both sort of alluding to, the fact of also education on the ground, you know, the health support system, does that really exist? Because I know in a lot of pockets that, you know, it's just non-existent. So what should the government really be doing?
Actually, I don't think the government is doing anything in that direction. Mm-hmm. Only some NGOs and institutes are doing for their own. And public as such per se, they are not having any advantage from the government side. They are not even thinking of that. Like there should be mobile vans in which they are having screening, all that gadgets like memo as well X-ray and blood test and pap smear test, although it is not feasible in the mobile van. I think there is a cheaper test like VIA. For cervical cancer, we have indigenized version of detecting the cervix cancer. So all these things can be in mobile van, initiation should be taken from the government side.
But may I say something here?
Yeah.
You know, I you hold a camp, you tell people you're coming, doctors are coming. And often in these areas, they have many other ailments that need to be attended
so
to and there isn't a doctor.
Issue.
So anyone with a problem comes. As I said, you need to catch people who are in a high risk category.
Mm-hmm.
Now for that, you need to do some spade work before that. You need to identify people who are at high risk. Then you need to persuade them that they need to come. Even though they may feel there's nothing wrong with me. That's when you're going to catch those cancers. Early enough for them to be treatable. Because often what happens, you've got these camps, but you don't pick up a cancer at all.
Mm-hmm.
Because someone at high risk is not coming there. It's people with colds, ailments, other gynecological problems, often STD infections, all that kind of thing, who turn up there. And not necessarily the people who are, you know, the users of tobacco and have been for a long period of time, or women who may have had accidents at childbirth and at a high risk for cervical cancer, then multiple children, pregnancies, etc., or the HPV virus, they may be infected by that.
Mm-hmm.
Now in Tata Memorial, I know they have a rural project and they have been trying to integrate that at the primary level with the health system there. They're using ASHA workers
mm-hmm.
so that, you know,
the
they have
workers.
So that what they do is they use acetic acid, isn't it?
Yeah.
And
visual inspection.
They have visual inspection.
VIA test.
Aabolia doctor.
Yeah,
and that has been very successful,
yeah,
hasn't it?
Yeah, I just now told you.
Yeah.
That is a VIA cheaper test of detecting the cervical cancer.
Yeah.
It's just by applying the acetic acid on the mouth of that uterus, vagina, and we can visual inspection, there is a whitening, that is called aceto whitening,
yeah.
which can very well tell it's there, maybe in the earlier stage, or pre-invasive, pre-malignant stage.
Yeah, and this, you know, an ordinary ASHA worker can be trained to do this.
Okay. So we're just running out of time. So I'm going to get Mishti also to just give, you know, sort of step in. You know, the Lancet Journal report and the discussion that's happened here, the idea that perhaps we need to spread ourselves out. Do you see that as a very crucial thing right now? I think just breaking those barriers?
Most definitely, because at least in India, there are far too many gaps between what needs to be done and what is happening. There are the only assistance I really see is from doctors and from well-meaning NGOs like Ms. Gupta's. I don't think the government is on board yet. Okay. It should be.
Harmala, top line, what is the next priority to sort of stem the tide?
I think we have to go into a complete emergency mode. You know, this is staring us in the face. What are we going to do about it? Our only chance is that we get the cancers early enough, we prevent the cancers. As I said, 70% is life related to lifestyle and your habits. You know, 40%, as we know, are related to tobacco. You have to declare an all-out war against cancer.
Absolutely. And Dr. Danny, your last thoughts from a clinical perspective, next priority item.
Next priority means, as ma'am told, there should be like primary prevention. There's a level of intervention we should be there. Like primary prevention starts from the lifestyle changes,
sure.
Like should spread awareness about tobacco related cancers. There are so many cancers which are directly related with tobacco, either smoking way or chewing tobacco. And like next level of prevention is like early detection and diagnosis. That is the most important part. And these two things should be there with which we can tackle this alarmingly high incidence of cancers.
All right.
In our society.
Thank you so much, Harmala. Thank you so much, Dr. Danny Gupta. And thank you so much, Mishti, for joining us there via Skype. Of course, prevention is really, primary prevention is really the answer to stemming the rising tide of cancer. Do continue joining in the conversation on our website, indiapostlive.com. You can also continue tweeting with us at hashtag IndiaPostLive. Thank you for watching.